Welcome to the Haruka podcast, everyone. I'm your host, Aspirety, and joining me this week we have Kanon.
Bear Skull!
Pepe! And joining us for the first time, Odin Beard McSparkle.
Hey everyone, thanks for having me.
I feel like Odin Beard's the straight man in this group.
I don't remember the melody, unfortunately, I'm sorry.
You can't control Kanon when it comes to Haruka.
Isn't that what Haruka's all about?
You can't control Haruka, yes.
So speaking of not controlling Kanon, I'm going to control Kanon by giving him this 30-second recap.
Oh no!
Oh no! This is horrible!
In the next route of Little Busters, Ricky decides to forego his roommate in favor of hanging out with Best Girl. Join Ricky as he helps Harachin get the latest yahaha in her battle with the definitely not related to her disciplinary committee head, who's a total bitch, by the way, in a fun adventure involving marbles, troublemaking, hair-sniffing, romance, also self-loathing child abuse and suicide. For the best route for the best girl.
Ha ha ha, that was a really funny recap, Kanon.
Thanks, I worked hard.
It's definitely not recorded in post or anything. Wait, this isn't the crew guy.
Okay. Yeah, haha.
So, guys, first impressions. How do we feel about this route? Odin Beard, you're a veteran, aren't you?
I'm a newbie.
You're a newbie,
aren't you? Wait, your first time reading Little Busters?
I've seen the anime, I had not read the VN yet, so this is my first time reading the VN, yeah.
You're a veteran.
Yeah.
But yeah, still, first time reading the VN, how do you feel about it?
I've been really enjoying it, absolutely loving it, to be honest. In some ways, like, there's certain things I feel like the anime did better, like, just small things, not to get too off topic, but I feel like Rin, I felt, was a better character in the anime than the VN, so far at least. But overall, like, I'm enjoying the extra, you know, time and, you know, detail that is provided in the routes, you know, as opposed to the anime, which are stuck to the 20-22 minute marks, you know, where they have to fit a lot of stuff in.
I mean, like, most of the routes
and
fit
in such
like
a small amount of episodes.
Yeah, most of the routes fit into 60 minutes total. That's just, it's a lot of detail you're missing out. So Haruka's route, like, how have you felt rereading that?
Again, it hit me really hard. I can relate on a certain level to some of her experience. Not exactly, you know, I wasn't in as bad of a situation, I would say, but I have a bit of a contemptuous relationship with my family. So in that respect, it hit me with a lot of feels. At points, I was super angry. Other points, you know, I was really sad and cried a little bit. It was really emotional, and overall, like, I found it incredibly grounded, incredibly relatable, more so than I think any of the other routes in the VN, at least for me personally.
I definitely think...
You did post about that on the forum, yeah?
Yeah.
And I commend you. I have a lot of respect for you for opening that up on the forum, because I really love seeing how people, you know, how people relate key stories, or any stories for that matter, to their daily lives and to what has happened to them, because like, every story will affect us differently, so I really like seeing how it affected you differently, how it affected other people differently. So yeah.
Yeah.
Kudos.
For me, a lot of times with these routes and these characters, I tend to enjoy them more when I can relate to them personally. That's one of like my biases. So in that respect, I really enjoyed Haruka as a character and the route overall as a whole.
And I think that works for everyone. And so yeah, I'm really glad that it's been able to touch you personally.
Kanon, how do you feel about Haruka route?
Oh, it's just as good as I remember.
I'm glad.
That's so good, man. Like, Odin just called it grounded, and that's, like, kind of unusual for Key, because it's all, like, Key magic usually. So that makes it stand out.
I mean, like, it's definitely the most grounded route of all the Little Busters, because there's a lot of weird stuff happening in the other routes.
Yeah, there's some crazy stuff going on in other routes, but it's like, this one's just so, it's like, how do I describe this? it's got more emotional impact because there's not, like, magic there, and you're like, yo, this shit could happen. Is that a thing? Is that a thing people could think?
Yeah, it's like real drama, I mean, in a way.
Yeah.
I appreciate I appreciate those more like abject stories for like different reasons than I appreciate, say, Haruka's Root.
Yeah.
Right.
But Haruka's Root's got a lot of fucking raw emotion.
It does. I think it's probably the heaviest of all the roots in terms of emotion.
Like that scene when she just flips out and she's screaming at Ricky.
No, the voice acting.
That creepy laugh.
Suzuki Keiko. Suzuki Keiko, shout out.
Yes. Suzuki Keiko is amazing.
Yeah, seriously.
Really, really good. Outstanding performance.
It's these things that makes VNs worth reading, really. Yeah. Especially voice VNs.
I mean, like, reading Kanon's post in the topic was like, it's like seeing a new person. It's like, when you see Kanon, it's like he's talking about his crush.
I am.
Oh.
And it just feels...
It is so my innocent. Crush.
And, like, he talks about his crush differently than how he talks about everything else. Exactly,
it's the kind of innocence we never see from Kanon.
It is true.
Waifuism is weird.
Yeah. I pat you on the back.
But all that shit's genuine.
Yeah.
I can look at them and be like, did I write that? But that's genuine.
I don't deny it. It's like, while reading your post, it's like, yeah, that sounds like something that you genuinely feel.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I commend you for that.
Mm. How do you feel about the root, Pepe?
How do I feel about it?
I feel
really good. I quite enjoyed it. Like, I think, in my opinion, this is the most well-written root in Little Busters. I guess some background. Like, when I first read Little Busters, this was actually the first root I read, because I wasn't following walkthrough or any route guide. I was just playing by ear. I was like, oh, where should I go next? And I ended up in Haruka's route. And like, I guess it didn't affect me as much back then because I was just starting and I didn't really have that much time to internalize everything. But I just remembered, hey, I really enjoyed this route. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm playing it again, it's like, I really enjoyed this route.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because there's so much to think about, not just with like what the root is trying to say and what the messages is trying to give, but everything that happens. Like, there are so many things that happen that you really need to stop and try to understand, like, who's doing what, who's posting these posters, who's getting angry at who, what exactly is kind of the thinking.
There's a lot to consider.
Right.
Sometimes, like, I feel like this route might be a bit too complicated for its own good, but that's up for debate.
Maybe.
I feel like the web of relationships gets a bit too crazy at points, and like the web of like dynamics.
I technically, you could say I read this route for the third time before I actually understood it, because after I read it for the second time, I started again, this time with different choices, but still getting the good ending. I kind of skimmed over everything. I just tried to read the important parts, and that's when I really got it. So it's like, a lot of the things, a lot of the weird shit makes sense in hindsight. Who's putting the posters? Like, at first glance, you might think it's Kanata putting up the posters, but after reading again, you realize, it's not Kanata.
Mm.
The only thing they never really understand is what do Komari and Rin study that makes Rin into a sleepy kitty and gets locked into the room. I don't know. If you remember that scene. That was the way Komari invites her to, like, oh, come on, Rin, let's study. Okay. I can't get that out of my head. I'm sorry.
There's going to be lots of missable scenes in this room, especially depending on which roommate you pick. You gotta get Kanta for your roommate for good. I feel like any other option, you're gonna be missing out on a lot of content in this route. Some of it gets kept in if you don't pick her, but you get the most if you have that happening. But yeah, as for my thoughts about this route, I've kind of, like, after I've read it again and like talked about it on the forum and talked about it with a bunch of people over the last week or two, I've just been like, keep rethinking my thoughts, and I've kind of gone through these stages of grief with this root. And I feel like I've finally reached a point where, like, I feel like I understand it. I feel like I have some pretty good answers to some of the questions it poses. So I guess this podcast will be the final test to see how much I truly understand this root. We will see.
I've been trying to observe you, Aspie, ever since we had that talk about how, like, you didn't understand Haruka's root. And I was like, I wonder how Aspie will finally get to understand this, because I was trying to explain it in words that I couldn't put my thoughts into words, essentially.
Mm. Well, it depends on which premises you accept as true. And that could really change how you view your story. It's like, there's too many variables.
Yeah.
I feel like that might be a problem, but I don't know. Anyway, let's not get into that too much right now. If you've been playing along with our book club, this is probably around the point where you're going to be encountering Master Saito, I hope. If you haven't, spoilers. Basically, what's going on here is he is a secret final boss of the battle rankings. To access him, you have to play through the battle rankings and get Riki to number one. And then when Kurigaya joins the team, if Riki is number one, I think he gets pushed down anyway.
Yeah, he gets pushed down to the last, no matter what ranking.
I'm not 100% sure on the conditions,
at.
But, like, after Riki gets pushed down to the yes. bottom, you need to work your way back up. And if you do it, like, yes. quick enough, then you will unlock Master Saito, and he will start rising up in the rankings, and then he will challenge you at first place. And if you manage to beat right. him, you become the strongest, and it's quite a fantastic scene. It's very hard to beat him.
You,
like,
get a Steam achievement.
Yeah, you get a Steam achievement. He is quite tough, and I don't know. Right. I think he's absolutely hilarious personally.
Absolutely.
The Saito character in Little Busters.
The strongest Saito.
It was through Haruka's playthrough that I got Master Saito, and I was trying to get Master Saito, and I forgot that you needed to get first place before Kurigaya came on. Mm. And then when I finally got him on, it's like, okay, time to wander. And every time he wanders, like, because he doesn't challenge the players all the time. So I was just sitting on first place with Riki. I was just waiting for him to get there. And by the time the final baseball day came, he was just on third place, and he never challenged me. And I was so sad. And
you probably got it too late. Yeah.
Maybe.
He spent so long going back and forth with Kurigaya. By back and forth, I mean kicking the shit out of her, but she just kept coming back.
That happened to me. Kurigaya kept beating me up at one point. Just wouldn't let me rise up the ranking.
I think it was Mio who beat Master Saito once, thanks to the Science Club.
Wow. Ugh,
fucking broken ass Science
Club. I actually had Kamari beat Master Saito once. It was actually amazing.
How?
Didn't someone get an achievement with Master Saito? It was like, I lost to Komari-chan.
I don't think that's an achievement.
That's... No, not an achievement. A title for Master Saito. Like, his title is basically, I lost to Komari-chan.
I can't remember what it was, but it's something like Garden Friendly is what I got from Master Saito from Kamari. Yeah, it's great to see that happen. But yeah, it's not much to say. It's just like kind of a little secret and kind of a big in-joke among the Little Busters community about Master Saito. I don't know. I love that guy. And just, like, the whole thing about, like, Riki being strong enough to get the mask, it's kind of a little bit of an emotional moment. It's kind of like a subplot that really demonstrates Riki's strength. I think it's really cool. I don't know. I just wanted to draw attention to that before we go in. And there's one other thing that you actually do unlock on this playthrough is the kick the can scene in the common route, which is another fan favorite.
Kankiri!
Kankiri. This is another fan favorite.
The anime didn't animate.
They skipped
the hyper kick the can. That's so sad.
Shout out to Haruka just, like, kicking the can and ruining the game for everyone.
Oh my god, that
was good.
Yeah, that was great.
It's perfect timing that you went to Haruka World after that, because, like, well,
Haruka destroying her own future. What about that?
So,
just wanted the satisfaction of kicking the can.
Yeah, I think this is a good time to talk about Haruka's character and all that entails. From the common route to her route, it kind of, we see a lot of progression there, and it kind of expands our perspective of her quite a bit. Kanon, you're up.
Yay! let's talk about both Harukas. The one that's a mask and the one that's real.
Hey.
Common Haruka is great. She's fucking hilarious.
She is.
What else can I say?
What were you going to say?
She's she's great, and what was it? Odin brought it up when he was talking about first impressions, how she brings the energy to the room. Brings out everybody's brings them all together to fuck around their newspaper sorts.
She's a noisy girl you can't hate, I guess.
Oh yes, noisy, very noisy. So that's good. That's a really good character. And then the real one comes out in the root. And that's also a good character. So that's the complete opposite of the one in common, right?
Right.
She's a depressed mess with the self-esteem of a brick. And that's great. I mean, it's not great, but...
It's not great.
It's great to read.
I need somebody who's more eloquent to describe what I'm trying to say.
Haruka is like... Many? I feel like once you see behind the mask, you just appreciate the mask so much more. It's kind of like... You appreciate her efforts, how damn hard she tries to fit in and tries to, you know, be amicable and pleasant to everyone, that it just makes you respect her all the more. Maybe some people will look at this a different way and think she's just hiding, you know, she's hiding from her past and she's running away, and she absolutely is, but damn, I love a character that feels human. I love that shit.
Yes.
So much more than just a character that's just a blank 2D archetype there to fill in a role. Haruka portrays her role as the Genki character from the get-go, and she's an excellent Genki character, but knowing that there's so much more to her and that isn't what defines Haruka is such a relieving thing, and it's this absolute thing I love most in key characters, in any characters. I love that shit. It's why I love Shiori. It's, you know, I could go on for ages, but it's really, really good writing.
Yeah,
there are multiple layers to this character. Haruka is like an onion.
No peeps.
It's like an egg, and when you like break the mask,
I'll take
it
egg.
Okay,
out.
Okay. Ow, no.
Like a cake. Yes. Helios has got like it over in the text. She's like a chiffon cakey. Delicious. Dry?
No.
going on
to my impressions of Haruka. She's like, the thing about noisy girls is, in many cases, especially in real life cases, they're the kind of people that would kind of tick you off, right? Despite being that archetype, she remains to be, well, lovable, because I guess you don't really see her ill intent. Like, how do I say this? A lot of noisy characters tend to be very also full of themselves, is what I'm trying to say. And Haruka is the complete opposite. She's not noisy because she thinks she's great. She's noisy because she, well, wants to have fun. Yes. And it's when we get into her route that we realize that, of course, she can't think she's great. She thinks she's shit. Well...
she's noisy because she wants attention and love because she doesn't fucking get any at home.
Exactly. And, I mean, it's a total reversal of the noisy character archetype.
Chaz the Haruka's
and
shitty
parent. And I think parent. This... I think this type of noisy person character is one that we'd see more in the real world, in our interactions with everyday life, right?
Yeah, this is...
It's usually the comedians, it's usually the people who... I'm going... What do you call that? Anyway, it's the people
class
who
clown.
Smile the most, who are hurting inside. Yes, the class clown.
Yeah, that's very true to life. I know a lot of people like that.
Can I just say shout-outs to her theme song? Because it's the melancholy of a noisy girl?
Right, actually.
That is actually like...
right there in the title of the song.
Yeah, that's such fucking fantastic.
We'll come back to that when we talk about how good this route is at foreshadowing and subtlety.
Let's talk about Kanto a bit.
Oh, that bitch.
Man, she's a bitch.
Best girl. What?
Oh.
I'm sorry. Do you want to say that again?
I'd like to hear what you think about Kanata.
Well, I think her position is obviously not very enviable. She's in an awkward place where, you know, even if, like, you hated your sibling, I don't think you really, like, at least in my case, I don't really, like, wish ill against, like, my brother personally, even though I have, like, some issues with him. So, still watching, if I was still, like, watching my brother get hurt in some way or pushed around, I'd still feel bad about it.
I have a lot to say about Kanata now. I've spent basically this whole week wrapping my head around her because the story gives us limited information to work with, and it makes it a bit hard to understand where she's coming from and why she does the things she does. Just. Basically, Kanata's fucking... She's fucked up, is a good way to put it.
Right.
I definitely believe she deserves to be punched in the face. But I still really like her.
Right. She is, I think she's doing it actively to, well, she's doing it actively to be hated, at least in the case of Haruka. Like, you see her interactions with other characters, and they're a lot more subtle and a lot more mild, especially with Kudryavka. And even with what's her name?
Sorry. Achan?
Even with Kurugaya.
Oh, Kurugaya.
I'm sorry, Kurugaya.
What? Okay.
Oh, you mean that girl who knew that Haruka had it bad but didn't do anything? Bitch.
Wow, okay. Actually, she did, didn't she? But I don't think it was in her place to really do anything about it. Anyway.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So, a lot of her bitchy attitude we see mostly with her interactions with Haruka.
Let me say something about Kanata. Her methods are garbage, but her intentions are good. Her intentions are fine. Her methods are garbage, and she deserves a punch in the face for those. Mm-hmm. But there was definitely good intentions there. Wait, that's Miyaru.
No, it's Haruka Root as well. Don't worry.
Do we want to talk about that? What we think her intentions are?
Because
this is a point that's been up for debate a lot in the last week on the forum.
Okay, sure, I'll say it.
Go, Ken.
The main intention of her disgusting attitude is she wants to protect Haruka. She thinks... She doesn't want Haruka to, like, get attached to anyone or anything. She doesn't want to get hurt anymore. Just taking things away from her is a bad way to do that. So when she sees Haruka, like, being happy with people, she's like, no, let's not do that.
We don't want her to get hurt again.
And, yeah, she doesn't want her to get hurt again. She just wants her to finish the school and bugger off.
I think it's partially that, and also, again, I think she is in a way forcing, like, a lot of these conflicts. I think one of her motivations, at least my interpretation of it, is that she wants Haruka to get to a place where she can have those things, and then if they happen to leave her or, you know, fall away in some way, she'll still survive. She'll be able to live on and, you know, move on from loss, which obviously she has trouble with up to this point.
Ah, so you think she's trying to make Haruka tougher by being a bitch?
Yeah, in a way, I think that's what she's hoping for, but I think you are more correct in that. I don't think she really thinks a peaceful solution is really possible. But she's hoping anyway, because, you know, that's normal, but I don't think that that's the total goal, but I think she's hoping for that.
Well, the root outward states that she's trying, like, maybe, like, the fights up until this point were just kind of, like, you know, an ongoing grudge between the two. They definitely, like, Haruka definitely incurred a bit of a wrath with all the, like, you know, the trouble she's been causing Kanata. Haruka is no saint here. But up in, like, when Riki starts getting involved, you can definitely see that the bullying from Kanata escalates. And you'll notice that the root actually says in text that her motivation is to get Haruka to leave the school, to drive her out, so that she can find her new place somewhere else. And another thing they also say, another thing Kanata says, is that she's hoping Haruka will revert. What do you guys think that means?
That's probably the most confusing part for me. Like, if she lets Haruka be, then Haruka will revert, right? Or is that what you're saying? If I take away everything she grasps onto, she'll finally be forced to revert. I think it has to do with, like, Haruka's attitude towards people. Like, she is doing things, as you mentioned, well, as Kan mentioned before, she's doing things to gain attention, right? And she's doing things to gain, what's the word for that? To be praised. She wants to be praised. She wants to be recognized. And I think that Kanata believes that if she takes away that, like, if she takes away her means of being recognized, then Haruka will be forced to finally believe in herself more instead of believing in what people tell her. And I think Kanata believes that, even though it's obviously wrong. Like, yeah, I think, again, good intentions. She wants Haruka to grow. She wants Haruka to stop being dependent and, well, to be able to be her own person despite all of the stigma behind her background. But her means of doing it is just basically taking away everything, which, as we can see, that's not the best way to do it, you know?
Too forceful for my precious child.
Yes, too forceful for
Kanon's
precious
child. I actually have an answer.
Child.
I have an answer. I've reached this. Maybe not so much about what the reverting means. You know, that's probably more what you said. Closest I can think of anyway. But in terms of her intentions, I have an answer I've reached here. And I feel like it's that she has basically been imprinted with some really fucked up values from the family. After years of teaching and being like enforced with these values, they've been imprinted on her, and she's kind of taken them on her own as a means of coping with the guilt of what she's doing. She's convinced herself, as her family has been telling her this whole time, that what she's doing, the way she's abusing Haruka, is for her own good. And as long as Kanata believes that lie, then she doesn't have to suffer the guilt of what she's doing. And I think that's pretty much what's going on here. It's like she's been infused with a value she doesn't fully believe in, but she has to believe in it to maintain her sanity, basically. How do you feel about that?
I mean, she kind of hates herself in Harakaru.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's after the barrier has broken down, because up to that point, she's still being like cruel and merciless with Haruka.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
it's like when you break down the wall, she's like, I actually have been like fucked up this whole time. It's just I didn't want to admit it because like I wanted to believe it was for your own good, but it's not. I think that's kind of like it's basically breaking down these years of imprinting these fucked up values from the Sagasa family. Or is it the Futaki family?
The whole If I am happy, she cannot be happy, and if she's happy, I cannot be happy.
Right, yeah.
Sort of thing. So maybe she's doing it on herself so that Kanata won't be happy, and
well, that's
kind
of that's
happy.
That's another kind of paradox of the root too, right? Because Kanata always brings up this point about the zero sum game, how one of them has to be happy for the other to be unhappy. But then she never explicitly says which one's the happy one.
Right. She thinks that Haruka might be the happy one because she's obviously unhappy. And Haruka thinks that Kanata might be the happy one because Haruka's obviously unhappy. But neither of them are unhappy.
But I think that's
the whole
point of this like cycle of hatred that they've both got themselves caught up in that they find so difficult to break up
right.
Because they've just been...
They're both unhappy, so Kanata's stupid logic doesn't work anyway.
Yeah.
If they're both unhappy, then who's the happy one?
Yeah. I think she's like blissfully unaware of that, though. Because she probably sees most of the times, you know, Haruka's running around making trouble and, you know, like throwing marbles down the hallway and stuff, and she probably thinks she's having a good time.
I really feel like up until the moment that Sagasa show came around and those posters started coming up, Kanata had fully demonized Haruka and she'd become an absolute enemy. it's only around that point that she starts actually showing her sisterly feelings. When it starts really becoming a problem for Haruka is when she starts feeling sorry for her. Up until that point, they're just like fucking making each other's lives miserable. Like Haruka is deliberately going out of her way to fuck with Kanata, and Kanata is going out of her way to put her down, you know, make her know her place. It's like, it's a cycle that's been going for like a long time now.
The first time we see this happening is when we see Kanata break her character. Mm. She starts to panic and she approaches Haruka asking what she did.
Did you put the posters up?
It's never really explained. Yeah, exactly. It's never explained at that point what she's worried about. And it's only later on where we realize that it was the posters she's worried about. And we see that Kanata is actually the first one to be worried about all of those posters, even before Haruka.
I think Haruka was at the time just thinking, everything's fucked anyway, so why should I care?
So, which begs the question, like, what was she worried about, right?
Doesn't Riki make a note, like, when they have that confrontation and Kanata's telling Haruka about the posters that, like, he thinks she's actually worried about her? Like, that's, like, a sisterly moment for her? Or am I misremembering something? Because I swore that happened.
Right. As the route goes on, Riki eventually realizes that Kanata does, like, feel... like, have feelings for Haruka. It's just... it's so twisted behind these layers and layers of twisted logic that Kanata has built up around herself as a defense mechanism. That's really how I'm choosing to view this route now. It's just Kanata trying to cope with the situation the only way she knows how, and it's fucked up.
And her way is awful.
Yeah.
I think the reason why it's so hard to gauge exactly what Kanata's intents are is because they're so multifaceted.
Yeah.
At one, like, she wants to protect Haruka. At the same time, she also wants to protect herself. And her means of protecting Haruka are both to protect Haruka from herself and to protect Haruka from the family. And she's trying to do so much, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She's trying to do so much, also being, well, the only one actually aware of the situation between the two. Whereas Haruka is the more, well, you know, just... Haruka's,
she's the victim!
Just, yeah, she's the victim. Whereas Kanata is both a victim and the perpetrator in this case.
To be fair, like I've said, Haruka isn't blameless.
Right.
I think that's one thing Kanata comments on. It's like, always playing the victim, you make me sick. And it's like, yeah, she's being a bitch, but she does have a point.
She's right. No, I think that's also one part that she wants Haruka to grow in. And it's this multifacetedness that we also see in Kanata's character that makes Kanata such a good character, despite her being such a bitch.
She is a well-written character, that's for sure.
All right, fine. She's a well-written character.
I don't know, like, I still haven't read Kanata's route, so maybe there's, like, more room for me to empathize with her. I mean, like, I do empathize with her, even if it's all fucked up. Like, this is a person who has... like, at least Haruka has been free from the family for however many years. Kanata has still continued to live under their roof and had to deal with all that bullshit for this
under
long.
Their rules.
Yeah, under their rules.
Right.
And, like, she's had to suffer a lot. We need to be, like, empathetic about that and understand that that's what's led to all of this in the first place. Now,
she also mentions about her scars, which, well, I mean, both of them were beat pretty bad as kids, but Haruka doesn't mention anything about scars, whereas Kanata is, well, it's there. So I'm not trying to say that Kanata had it worse or that Haruka had it worse. Point being that they both had a shitty childhood, which is sad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, fuck that family, eh?
Yeah, fuck so that family! I'm gonna burn that goddamn house down!
About that family. So... I mean, obviously, the story does try to point out the family as being, well... fucking evil. But... well, where was I going?
The family is evil. I don't think it's like...
yeah, the family and their systems are evil. But we never really get to see, like... who this family is made of, right? Like, we don't see who does what. We just see that they're too blinded by their dogma about the glory of the Saigusa family, to the point that they pretty much sacrifice the children who would potentially lead the Saigusa family in the future.
Mm. It seems like a very like religious sort of thing. Like they talk a lot about how like they used to worship the kami, but then they lost that, so they just worship their own blood instead. It ends up becoming a very like disgusting sort of system that's very self-centered.
Right, and the worst part about this whole thing is that neither Haruka nor Kanata can find themselves to blame the system, because that's the system that they grew up with. That is what is to them fact.
There was one person who rebelled against the system. The guy that ruined their lives.
Oh, yes. Hey, man. He didn't ruin their life. Well, yeah, Saigusa Show. And we do see by the end that their main goal really was to free themselves and their family from the grip of that.
And they fucking ruined everything, eh?
Yeah, they did.
Well, I guess it worked out in the end.
Also good intentions.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. So, where you going with this, Pepe?
Where was I going with this? So, actually, that's... Aside from the shitty family, I would like to think more about their not shitty family, aka their mother and their fathers.
Dubiously shitty family.
Dubiously shitty family, maybe. Like, okay, so by the end of the story, we see that they did have good intentions. Like, Saigusa Sho did have good intentions, becoming an asshole. But, like, Haruka's mother, well, Haruka and Kanata's mother, and the other father, like, we only get to see a small part of them, and in that part, they kind of act like robots, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think one point I'd like to bring up is why do they treat Haruka this way?
I think they're absolutely terrified that they'll break her if they poke too hard.
Mm. Right.
That fits a lot, yeah.
I mean, she is...
Yeah.
I mean, they're not entirely wrong. She's pretty much made of glass.
I remember there being a scene where I think either Haruka or the parents talk about how, like, she wasn't supposed to, like, talk at the dinner table or whatever, and if she did, she would get hit and stuff like that, so she's accustomed to, like, not talking during eating, so I thought that was the reasoning.
But there's a bit more to just the dinner table. Like, even for their family situation, they never really bring things up. They never really try to fix, well, anything. And, I mean, I guess that could be related to how they don't want to break Haruka. They just want her to enjoy her school life now that she's able to participate. But as we can see, that doesn't really work out very well, because it doesn't really make her feel like she has a family.
God damn it. These guys. They're in a position to help, and they do nothing.
Right, again, well, good intentions. Bad.
The mother was raised by Team Shit Family up there, so she's gonna be fucked up in the head anyway.
That's true. They do kind of mention this, yeah.
And the other father is the kind of beta male who's fine with being in a
being cucked
in a relationship with a woman who's also with another man. So he,
I think they're all fine with it, understand. By the way.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm sorry.
Actually, I don't think we'd be able to clear it up.
He tried to burn the goddamn house down.
Yeah, he did try to. That's... he is a hero.
He was. He's just a fucking bum now. Well, stealing purse, like...
I don't think...
harassing old women and
stuff. He tries to be an asshole, but he's a good guy deep down.
So, yeah, I know they're incompetent robots, but they've been through some shit.
Hmm.
And I think they just don't want to break their fucking precious child.
Yeah.
My precious child.
I think, well, I don't think we'll get an answer to this in this podcast, but it's kind of confusing as to how they all fit in the family. So, Saigusa Sho is a Saigusa, right?
No.
No, he's not?
No. The mother is the one who was born into the family.
Oh, so the two husbands are
He would have taken that name because Saika said, "Oh, it's his big fancy name. You ought to take our big fancy name. Look at how good we are."
Right.
And he did those things after the wedding night, after he legally changed his name to Saigusa.
Hmm. Seems it.
Right.
I think at one point he just sits down and thinks, you know what, this is bullshit.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm going to burn that fucking house down.
Oh, well. He wants to protect his child. He wants to burn the house down. Yeah, he's right.
Oh shit!
Gotcha, fam. Nope.
And Haruka's mother basically is just her with a darker hair color. Fuck.
Uh oh. Well, somebody needs to put in a picture of Haruka's mom from the anime.
Fucking 10 out of 10 design.
Yeah.
Hang on. I don't want to say that they're not at fault, but I think I can sort of understand why they don't want to poke it. Incompetent.
The most we can learn from Kanata's and the rest of the families, well, the immediate family at least, is that they all had good intentions, but they had very bad implementation? No. What's the word for that?
Just go with
methods.
They had very bad methods. They had very execution. There we go.
Mm.
They had good intentions. They had bad execution. Just like many anime that we see nowadays.
I'm wondering, like, what are the good methods here then? Because this is like an incredibly delicate situation.
Right.
I'm just not sure. There's too many other options of ways to approach.
They're all
this.
Surrounded by invisible chains that are sharp as blades and can sever connections at any moment.
Yeah.
I know, like, a lot of the forum has been talking about the head family and how, like, they're obviously the cause of all this misfortune, and yes, that is correct. A lot of people have been debating whether or not we can actually start accusing the individuals that make up that family as, you know, culpable for this or not. And that's like a lot more of a gray area, even like completely undeterminable, because we don't know anybody from that family at this point. We don't know anybody that was abusing Haruka and Kanata. We know someone has been, but we don't know any of the faces behind that. We don't know why they're doing what they're doing. We can only assume it's selfish, but that's still an assumption, right? I feel like with the lack of information we've been presented, it's like, it's the story is basically trying to tell us that they don't want us to go looking for a culprit in this family. Like, that's not the point of the route. In fact, the point of the route is the exact opposite. And the whole point being that we don't need to find a culprit to throw all of our blame on. Like, even if there is somebody culpable for something, that doesn't mean we need to find them. We can just, like, move on with our lives and stop spreading this cycle of hatred. I'm jumping ahead a bit.
Which brings us to the message of the route.
Right.
And that's elegant and all, but they also threaten to kill a child to manipulate.
They do that. So, you know. Yeah, they do. But I still think it's not the focus of the story, and I feel like spending too much time at that point, it's just kind of getting further and further away from the root, which we don't want to do.
Right. I think I'm pretty much subscribed on this thought, is that what the route is trying to teach us is like Aspie said, in many cases of like when we see a lot of bad happening, there's never really a supervillain to this kind of thing. There's never really one person that we can point to blame. And I think that's why the wording of, well, the way that the message is worded, that there are no evil ones in this world, is what the route is trying to say. Whenever really bad shit happens, whenever we see evil that is done by huge groups of people, when you try to understand like every individual in that group, it's harder to see that evil. It's only when they come together, when that hatred is formed into a chain, as the story says, that it becomes something that you just can't challenge. And I think the only way to break that chain is to go back down to the individual and stop the hate, you know?
It would have been a nice thing if the story focused on it, but it feels like less of a focus in this room.
I mean,
I really like the message, Pepe. I wonder how relevant it is to the root, because I don't really spend any time talking about the family.
It takes the characters a lot of time just to realize this. I mean, that's just the first part, trying to figure out what's the problem.
Well, Riki does say they're fighting an invisible force that's like might be society or some grand thing that they can't directly challenge.
Right. And I'll give you that. I mean, I think that's the problem you had and also Macklemore had, in that they don't really show the fight that the Haruka and Kanata have against that evil in society. The route is really more focused on their internal conflicts. Oh, it's not? No. Oh, okay, well. Well, alright then. I guess it's mostly Macklemore. I'm sorry, Macklemore. But yeah. And that's one thing that maybe the route tries to misdirect you to, or maybe it's... I mean, it would have been nice to see it, but that's not really the point of this story. The point is to see Haruka and Kanata's internal struggle and how they overcome it. The point is to see...
Oh, good, you got there in the end.
Yeah, exactly.
Point I was is waiting see... for you to finish. I was waiting for you to finish, and because if you didn't bring that up, I was going to say... Yeah, that nobody cares about that stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
It's about Haruka and Kanata.
I think Pepe is still talking about Higurashi, to be honest.
What? Oh. I never got over Miyakashi, I'm sorry.
This is a character root. It is about the characters.
This is a character root about the character, and while it would have been nice to see their fight against society... throwing marbles down the streets and anarchy and whatnot. I think I like the story we got, and I like the message we got. And I think that message is something that is very relevant in today's society.
Even if I could only agree with two-thirds of it.
I was just going to say, bouncing off Pepe here, I found like the final message ultimately being, you know, a certain degree about like forgiveness and, you know, letting go of those grudges and all that, you know, hatred that you hold on to. And I found that particularly powerful because ultimately, like I said, with my family situation, that's something I desperately want in my own life.
This is literally the spiral of hatred.
Yeah,
the reverse, and about how to break free of that. And that's the answer they give is fucking love, man. It's as simple as that. Because Riki was able to truly love Haruka and like tell her, you know, that I'm here to support you. That was all she needed to like break free.
All you need is love.
And then fucking she faints in Riki's arms.
Romances.
Let's talk about the romance for a bit, eh?
I love the romance in this room.
It is very good.
I've literally turned to jelly.
I don't know. I feel like a lot of these roots have made a point of how Riki is so compatible with the girl. I think it worked really good for Kamari and Mio. But the thing is about Haruka's root, they never really go out of their way to make it look like they're a perfect match for each other. In fact,
Haruka
even goes out of her way to say it could be anybody.
Yes.
But that doesn't make it any worse. Isn't that right, Kanon?
Haruka just needed somebody, and that's all that matters!
Hey.
Yay!
And then they talked about cheesy fucking lines, and it's amazing!
There's one thing Kanata couldn't do.
I love those cheesy lines.
Make me fall in love with you.
Hey!
Until he acts!
Hey! Boom! Yeah, that's one thing that I... It's one thing that I fondly remember from my first playthrough is the romance is just on point. It's sweet. It just makes you all go doki doki.
You can tell like Haruka had a crush on him.
Yeah, and I mean this is just one thing. This is something I realized just now. But I mean, when you did mention that when Kanon mentioned that it could have been anybody, I think that's kind of antithesis to romance in stories, because a lot of stories like to point out, oh, they're compatible because so and so, oh, they're soulmates, but really in the real world that isn't how love works, is it? I mean, you find someone who you can accept, who you can live with, who you can love, and you don't have to push that, oh, you're the only one that I could have loved in life. No, that's not, as long as you two can love each other and live life together, then that's all you need, you know?
Postmodern romance, baby. I love that shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really good.
I mean, good point that the route brings
up. It's just like they support each other, right? Mostly Riki supporting Haruka. Kanata is like very wary of this relationship because she just believes that Riki will like fuck up and get Haruka killed because he can't commit. And that's a very valid fear because that actually kind of happens in one of the bad endings.
Yeah, I wonder whose fault that is, Kanata.
Yeah. Oh.
But, so, you know, the fact that if you get this good ending, then Riki doesn't fuck it up and does manage to stick through to the end, it's like, hell yeah, that's like all, that's all Haruka needed. She didn't need to be saved. She just needed someone to tell her, I'm here for you. And that was enough for her to save herself. Really? This is such an important message because, like, that's the biggest...
It could have been her parents.
The biggest trigger to, like... lead someone down a dark path in life is to just have nobody there by your side. Isolation is what breeds crime and tragedy. As long as you have someone to support you, then fucking... As long as people love each other, the world would be a better place to live. Sorry.
Thank you, Aspie.
Fuck!
That's just great. Did anyone get that reference?
I got that reference, you fucking moron.
I did not.
You did not?
You did not.
At the end, they have to save themselves. But that doesn't mean we can't, you know, push them in the right direction.
Riki was a good boy in this route. Good boy.
Guiding.
He knew that Haruka needed to help herself and he couldn't, like, be her savior. Even though Haruka asked for Riki to be her savior, he was like, no, you gotta do this. I'm not solving this for you. Riki was a good boy.
I ain't gonna be your Kyosuke girl.
I mean, I mean, like, he kind of was in many aspects. There was that one scene where it's like, you know, Haruka's like, I wish I'd never been born. And Riki's like, no, fucking stop. You're not saying that. And then there's this little monologue where it's like, who said that to me in the past? Was it Kyosuke? I don't know.
I don't fucking care. Stop saying you want to kill yourself, you dumbass.
But yeah, that's like a really, like, interesting insight into Riki's character in one brief moment. He's been through this before.
Right. He's applying what he learned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's a good route.
Very good route.
Like, I do have, like, I've expressed that this route is a bit complicated and sometimes gets a bit confused and it can lead to people, like, focusing on fucking Hitler. But...
Why, ESP? We were doing so good!
But, yeah. The writing is so good in this route. Like, just the character writing, the interactions, it's...
Shit.
Chika Shirakiri, major props. I, like, really love her writing style. I'm assuming that's a she. Like, she's done both the Haruka and the Kudru.
And Kudru after.
Let's not get into that. Anyway. But yeah, I mean, I think the best part about the writing here is that so no character is left forgotten. In a sense, like all of the problems that are brought up have a purpose, and that's what makes this writing so tight. It doesn't, you know, try to add on things that don't really add to the greater narrative of
the politics of the family.
Shut up, Aspie.
Well, it kind of does because without those politics, without that bad guy, Haruka and Kanata wouldn't be in the position where they'd hate everyone.
I know. Maybe I'm just focusing on the wrong
thing. Haruka doesn't hate everyone.
I mean, they're still
she
there.
She hates herself, not everyone.
Oh. Well, yeah. Anyway, they're still there.
And Kanata, but yeah.
And even if at the end their existence is unresolved, I mean, it's... At least I think it... The story shows enough that you don't need to you don't need to get all bothered about it, is what I'm trying to say.
I mean, like, my one of my big problems with this route was, like, the whole ending feeling unresolved because, like, assuming that Kanata was doing all this for Haruka's sake so that Haruka would be fucking killed then it's a very good reason not to do these things, and then just making up at the end puts them both in grave danger. And I was, like, feeling like, what the hell? Like, what's going on with this ending if, like, they're both still in danger? Like, that's not an ending, that nothing's been resolved. But I've changed my thinking to thinking that maybe the threat isn't as big as Kanata thinks. Because, like, this whole talk about culling one of them happened when they were kids, right? And I think someone brought this up. I think it might have been Naoki. I'm not 100% certain.
It was Naoki, yes.
Brought up the idea that,
I thought it was me.
Oh, was it you?
Could I brought it off. I don't know if somebody else did.
Maybe multiple people did, but they brought up the thought that, you know, this threat has diminished greatly over the years. They're practically adults now, and if one of them just goes missing, the police won't, like, stay uninvolved. You know, that's gonna cause a lot of problems for the family. So, it's like their bind, their grip on these two children is a lot weaker than it used to be. I'd say there's probably more danger for Kanata because she's directly involved with the family, and there's probably still gonna be some obstacles there they have to deal with, but I'm feeling positive that the route able to end on this note is okay, because the point is that they have broken that cycle, they've made that step to understand each other, and then they should be able to overcome whatever challenges await in the future together. I think that's okay. I think I've come to terms with that.
Yay, and I'm glad you have.
Because that's the real ending, and focusing on it is stupid! It's like Aspie said, I think that the sisters... Hey, the sisters, by the way, did we mention that?
Hey, the sisters.
Kind of stupid how they tried to hide that fact. They designed them like that.
Yeah.
I think the sisters, well, Kanata
especially. There's a rumor that they're sisters. Did you hear, Riki?
Gasp!
treated that threat as way more than it is. I think it was more to just completely manipulate her. If it ever was a real, a genuine threat or just a tool for manipulation.
Yeah.
It's diminished. It's gone.
Yeah.
That threat doesn't exist.
I feel like she's kind of been holding herself to that threat as a means of coping with the guilt of what she's been doing to Haruka, right? It kind of goes back to what I was saying.
You said that earlier.
Yeah.
I think the start's a little bit boring.
I get what you mean. Like, it kind of like, it ties into the common route very seamlessly. Like, there's a lot of like, just random shenanigans going on for the first hour or so.
Yeah, I think some of that should have been intertwined with common, so it's not chunk at the start.
That's valid.
Haruka cleaning the cafeteria and whatnot.
Yeah, that should have been in common route. Let's talk about Kud a little bit, actually. Not her route, but how she functions in this particular route.
I'd see you guys in 10.
The cutscenes are great! What are you talking about?
Yeah, she's the little sister that Kanata tried to have, but she shouldn't have had, you know?
Hmm. She had a little sister up fucking there, stupid fucking bitch.
Pepe.
But she didn't realize that. What?
Oh, maybe Earnbeard. Do you have anything to say about this?
The Kud parts? I thought they were... interesting. Again, it was really sad in the way, like, you know, when Haruka comes to that realization, sort of, that, like, she's being replaced in a way by Kud, and, like, she's getting that attention that she wants from Kanata, but it's going to Kud instead. I just found it really sad, to be honest.
Yeah, it's just like, Haruka, through Kud, Haruka is able to realize her hidden desire to be close to her sister. I think that's fucking great. Great use of the characters there.
Yeah, all of those moments, which apparently are a bit newer, where you see like Haruka, like inside Haruka's head, like her thoughts, all of those hit me pretty hard. Like they're just really sad, and it's really interesting to see. I wish they did that with a few more of the other routes and characters to see how they think, you know, inside. It would give, because I felt like it gave a lot of perspective.
Yeah, shout out to the extra content added after the original Little Busters. It's interesting stuff.
It was very compelling to see Haruka's argument with Kud about, like, oh, you don't know nothing about my family. And
it's
Kud
like
just,
one of the very
you know,
few times we
tries.
See the girls and Little Busters fighting. It's... You don't see it very often. And it fucking breaks my heart.
Yeah.
No.
Macklemore on chat raises a good point that Haruka tried to do the same thing with Kurugaya that Kanata did with Kud. she made Kurugaya her anego.
Yeah, that is true, actually. Yeah, that's earlier foreshadowing.
And that's it's very early foreshadowing, even from the common rule. Like, you wonder why she tries to push that anego role to Kurugaya, but once we get into her route, then, hey, she just wants a big sister that she never had.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question that I still think is a tad bit confusing. What were Kanata's intents in trying to pretend to be Haruka? Was it like a test for Ricky, or was she trying to make Haruka realize that Ricky doesn't really love Haruka, but she just wants the image of Haruka? Like, what do you guys think? I'd actually like to hear I'd like to hear Kanon's thoughts on this, honestly.
Maybe. She was trying to see, what's so good about this guy? Let me fucking see. and then she's like, oh yeah, he is pretty good. Let me do that again.
Oh. So are you implying that she kind of falls in love with him? A little bit?
No.
No?
No.
I think he's calling Kanata a slut.
No, I'm not.
I mean, the whole point is, like, you get the almost hate scene and it doesn't happen. Like, Kanata's just like, wow, you fucked up.
I think it's a bit of that.
He really does.
A bit of that and a bit of trying to fucking destroy Haruka because she's a bitch. With awful methods.
I mean, like, she said after it, like, Ricky asked why, and she's like, how many times do I have to tell you? I'm trying to drive her out. Like, she pretty much says that.
Right.
Trying to drive Haruka out of the school. But I also feel like there's a little bit of motivation there to test Riki's resolve.
Yeah, there we go. Because
she doesn't trust anybody getting close to Ricky and... getting close to Haruka and destroying her life, potentially. So she wants to, like, test him and see if he's up to the challenge. And honestly, Kanata's standards are so high that I don't think Ricky would ever be able to meet them until the very last scene where there's, like, the whole confession and everything.
How about how fucking dark it is?
I mean, yeah.
This shit's fucking dark.
It is. It's extremely dark compared to the rest of the VN up to this point.
Compared to Key in general, it's fucked up.
It's dark not in a way that, you know, very violent things happen. It's not dark in a way that you see in other much darker VNs, but it's dark in a very psychological way. It's dark in that, in a very self-deprecating way, is what I want to say.
It's dark because it doesn't pull any goddamn punches on its disturbing ass topic.
Yeah, I agree with that. Like, that whole classroom scene, you know, where she's basically, like, spilling her guts and, like, that fucking creepy laugh. Like, that was tripping me out.
Oh, my.
But it just, again, just listening to, like, her experiences and just, like, the religious aspect and stuff, like, I just was getting so mad, like, just hearing that shit.
Yeah.
Like, because I come from religious houses, too, and I got guilt tripped occasionally, and just, it was, I had to stand up from my fucking computer for a bit, like, I had to get out for a second.
I've said it a couple of times, I think the root deserves praise for evoking emotions, even if they're incredibly negative emotions of pure fucking rage.
Yeah.
Because it wanted to.
It is an incredibly evocative root. Gotta praise it for that.
And that's worth praise. Also,
I think that's why
route.
People like love this route so much. This is a very popular route because of that. The emotions it's able to evoke out of people.
It's very admirable when a piece of fiction is able to make you feel what the characters are feeling, and that's the kind of thing I really try to look out for when I'm reading something. Like, if the author is more than just words able to make me feel what the characters are feeling. And I think they did a very good job of making their point across.
It's a very emotional route and it's very well written, so, you know, it's just really good. Like, there's foreshadowing and there's left hands and citrus.
Yeah.
Actually, the whole left hand and citrus, and it's interesting. I don't know if it was just put in there for, like, plot. It's interesting how they're all very opposite to each other. Like, Haruka's left-handed, Kanata's right-handed. Kanata likes mint, Haruka likes citrus. Yeah, so they're very polar opposite to each other. And It does drive... Babes. Hmm? Sorry?
Blue eyes, amber eyes is a contrasting as fuck.
And that, blue eyes and amber eyes. And it does drive the point about... Well, maybe you could chalk it up to how they were brought up. Like, one was made to feel like shit, and the other was made to feel like they have to carry the whole
like
world.
Feel like shit.
While feeling like shit at the same time, yeah.
How do you feel about anyway, Kanata's catchphrase, you're not a god?
That's a catchphrase?
That's a catchphrase?
She says it a lot.
But yeah, she does say that a lot. She says it a lot to
I
Ricky.
I feel like she says the worst a lot.
She's
sight.
I really like.
I
feel like this is some Shinto stuff getting into it, but yeah, she definitely like has this idea of kami as like savior figures, probably further imprinted on her from her family, and this idea that, you know, there's nobody that's going to magically save you and whisk away your problems. I don't know.
And I think she thinks Ricky wants to be that. But she doesn't realize that Ricky isn't really going that way. Ricky just wants to... Ricky is not trying to be a god. He's trying to be a good boyfriend.
Ricky's trying to sniff that hair and get him some fucking kisses.
Hey, Kanon, how much hair sniffing is in Haruka Root?
About 4 lines worth? Hang on, let me check.
Oh my god.
So, one thing I want to talk about that's been a big focus of the discussion of this route on Kazumatsuri is the line at the end of the route where Haruka concludes that nobody is evil. There are no evil ones in this world. She uses a lot of lines like this. And people have reacted very strongly to these lines, basically saying that that's
fucking
stupid.
It's very controversial.
Of course there's evil in the world.
Yeah.
Like, of course there's people to blame, because... even going as far as Haruka's immediate life, her family's to blame for everything that's happened up to this point. Even if, like, we're making the argument of, like, whether it's a system of the family or whether it's individuals that we can blame, who cares? Like, there is actually people beating these people, these kids, and threatening to kill them. That's a thing that's happened. We can't ignore that. So they are deserving of blame for this. We've talked about how that's not really the point of the route. And that's how, what you brought up, Pepe, about how, like, it's about, like, learning to not blame people. And I think that's a great way to approach this, but then that doesn't really answer why Haruka would think that there's no one to blame, right? Interestingly,
right.
Forum resident Helios Alpha took this line and looked at it in Japanese, and he's like, you know... I don't think he doesn't say it's a bad translation, but he says that people tend to misinterpret it quite badly. The wording, I'm pretty much just going to read out his post, but basically, he chooses to translate this as at fault instead of evil or bad. People at fault. The word that's generally thrown around in Japanese
right.
is warui, so which is like literally bad.
Warui. And
so it's like
yeah.
the...
And people sometimes say warui, like, my bad.
Mm-hmm. And, like, basically, Helios's whole point here is that in Haruka's childhood, she was always told by her parents that she was at fault for everything. She was to blame. She was the bad one. And not because of anything she did. She was, like, practically a toddler by this point. Like, maybe not a toddler, but very young. She was being told that she was always the one at fault for everything that went wrong in the family. And she accepted that role as, you know, the one to be blamed. Even though, morally speaking, she hasn't done anything wrong. That's her role. And that's kind of like, it's instilled in Haruka this sort of idea that the world is split into people who are good and bad. People who... the haves and have not is what he said. People who are at fault and who are not. And so... basically, to cope with this all her high school life, she's determined that Kanata is the bad one, the person who is to blame for all this misfortune. But that's, like, just pushing what she perceived on herself onto someone else, right? And the whole point of this route is basically breaking that cycle of having someone fulfill that role of providing, you know, the misfortune for others, and understanding that maybe there doesn't need to be a bad one. It's about breaking free of this mindset. It's not about determining that there's no one bad
right.
in the world. It's just it's more representative of Haruka's transformation of needing to realize that she doesn't have to blame anyone. There doesn't need to be necessarily be someone that is just the well that all of the bad shit, you know, dwells in.
There is no super villain, essentially. There is no boogeyman.
Mm. It's interesting. It's very important that you recognize that she isn't necessarily talking about villains here, but she's talking about how she herself was treated when she was a kid. There doesn't need to be someone to fill that role, right, of having to, like, take upon all the misfortune themselves. You know, people can just be happy. It's like a transformation to the spiral of happiness by the very end.
Yeah,
I think that's a really good post, Helios. It's kind of opened my eyes to, like, think about this message in a bit of a different way and stop taking it so damn literally.
Right.
Because that's the thing that people have been really focusing on.
There are just so many interpretations of how this can go, and I think the best way to put it into one sentence is the way Macklemore put it, in saying that it's innocent until proven guilty, right? Like, I mean, one interpretation is, again, about there not being like an evil mastermind, but evil being part of a collective. And there's also the interpretation that there's no one at fault. But at the end of the day, this builds up to really just trying to understand, why is it that people do things? Why is it that we blame these people? And why is it that we hate these people? And I think it's because we as humans find it hard to get past our own emotions, and we're just really so quick to judge, we're so quick to blame, that we forget other people's situations. And you might align me as being lawful good or lawful whatever, but I think that's the reason why we have, well, legal process, because we need a way to filter out, like our whole legal process, at least for most countries, hinges on innocent until proven guilty. And there's good reason for that. It's because without trying to understand both sides, we won't really be able to find who is to blame, who is at fault, or, well, if there is anyone at fault at all. And it's, I think, this kind of mindset that people individually tend to forget. I mean, and when people individually tend to forget that, then as a group, people start to forget that. And I really don't want to get into this topic, so I'm going to stop now.
I mean, I want to keep this focused on Haruka and Kanata.
Yeah.
The whole brood is about teaching us empathy and, like, being able to understand that even though this person is obviously acting in ways that are pretty fucking bitchy and not at all okay, that doesn't mean we should stop treating them as humans worthy of, like, empathy.
Right. Correct.
I think that's exactly the thing that Haruka learns at the very end, is that she's able to accept that there was reasons for the things that Kanata did, and she doesn't need to keep living off that hatred to survive. She can just be chill, because now she has Riki. That's definitely like a big building block here. She wouldn't have been able to do that without someone to tell her, you know, it's going to be all right, I'm here for you. But because she had that, she didn't need the hatred to continue living day to day, and so she could just look at Kanata and say, you know what, I forgive you, fuck it, you know, you've done some shitty things, but we can move past this. And that's so powerful. I know Kanon talked about this a little bit in his forum post as well, how he initially hated Kanata.
Oh, you wanted me to come in with that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, she's a bitch. But I understand her.
So what made you change your ways?
And I'm fine with just letting it go. Because Haruka let it go.
Hey.
She's the one who got it worse from all that. And let me add to what you were saying, Aspie, about how at the end of this route, Haruka learns to, you know, get over it. She doesn't just learn to get over it, she also teaches Kanata to fucking get over it. And that's important. Mm. Like near the end of the room, she's like, Kanon is the one who's just being the grumpy, frumpy bitch who's just like, no, mm-hmm. stop trying to fucking be nice to me, Jesus. Piss off.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's because Kanata didn't have anyone to believe in her, to support her. But then
Haruka!
Haruka ends up being that person. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes, 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 you get it. That's where she's best girl.
Paving it forward.
I wish more people in this world would be able to read this route and get this message and put this message into practice. And I think our world would be a much better place than what it is now.
Yeah, I know Pepe did a big post that kind of like compared this to real world politics. I don't want to get into that too much in this podcast, but I think it's worth a read. I think it's a very insightful post that has a lot to do with this route and how it could be applied to our everyday lives. But yeah, just check that out if you have time. How's that, Pepe?
Smooth. Yeah, that's good. Satisfactory. That's good. That's as much as I wanted to say. Thank you. Okay, I never said this, but every time I write a post in the Haruka route, I feel like a goddamn hippie, and I love it. I feel like putting flowers into the guns of people starting wars, and that's what I want to do in the world.
That's so true. This is just like a love, not war story, and it's so simple, right. But it's so good. So good.
Yep. And even if you can forget, you don't have to forgive the fuckers on the mountain.
You're doing so well.
I'm sorry. I'm like 85% committed to the message.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, take this with a grain of salt. Not everyone is, like, fundamentally good. I don't think the root is trying to say that as much as some people think it is. But it is saying that, you know, if we take an effort to empathize with others, then maybe there will be unexpected results, you know? Maybe we could come out of this with a much more peaceful resolution than just blindly hating each other and throwing accusations at each other like that's the only thing we can do, you know? I think that's what this route is trying to get across, and yeah. I can totally get behind that. So,
I think it's common for people to, like, you know, internalize their own struggles and in that kind of way, not necessarily being selfish in a negative connotation, but just thinking about yourself in that way. Yep. And sometimes we forget, you know, that the other
person's emotions. These two were just, like, totally obsessed with their own situation and weren't able to think about anyone else. And that's when it changed. Thanks, Riki. You did good, son.
Clutch for Riki. Clutch.
Okay, so shout-outs to our forum posters for discussion of this route. We've got Helios Alpha, we've already mentioned some of his wonderful contributions. Odin Beard here, Kanon, you guys all did great posts.
Sparkly Beard, Kanon.
Yeah, bro.
Zelda Master 7453, Nav, CJ Lim 2007. We have Tito Lamar, Zante, Ganesh Swami, Naoki Saten. Yeah. Naoki did some phenomenal posts for this route. I really like what Naoki keeps doing with, like, he has different posts for different thoughts, and he'll keep coming back to the topic with new thoughts, and, like, each one is, like, adding more to the conversation. It's a really good way to do it. Instead of, like, just dumping all your thoughts in one post, he kind of spreads it out. I feel like we could all learn something from that. Really cool. And Macklemore as well.
Consistent quality from Naoki. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so I've decided to commemorate Pepe here as our MVP for this route.
Nani? I hope I was able to help spread the message to 1, 2, maybe 5 people. It's enough.
We also have some Haruka fanworks to take a look at. First up, we have this art by Black Hayate of Haruka and Kurugai here.
Aw, that's cute.
Really cute little drawing here. And we also have this art by Evanfish of an adorable Haruka and Dorge combination.
Oh my god, it's so fucking cute!
It is.
No.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I want to poke both of them.
Don't you poke my fucking waifu.
This is kind of... This can't just remind the scene where Haruka is, like, leaning over Riki, like leaning her head on his.
Oh, so you can see his worldview?
No, yeah, I think that's totally intended. But it's Dorge.
Yeah.
I wish we could see the world the way Dorge does.
So yeah, thanks for joining us this week, guys. It was great to get you on for this one. Sorry Biz couldn't be here.
Biz!
Next week we're going to be talking about the Good Route. I've got quite a lot to say about that one. It's definitely going to be a bit of an interesting podcast because that's a weird route, just putting that out there. But yeah, I'm really looking forward to talking about that one. And that's our last Heron route before we jump into Refrain. We're getting to the end of the rope, guys. How's everyone feeling?
I'm already past Refrain,
so...
I've
already done the EX routes.
Just pretend! Yeah. Pretend!
Yeah. Oh, I'm so excited!
Super excited, man, dude.
I'm hyped to reread what I consider Key's greatest combination route, if you will. Greatest culmination route.
True route, peeps. We'll call it the true route.
Anyway, thanks for joining me once again, guys, and we'll see you for the next one. Catch you later, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Peace.
Shaka shaka, hey!